Yes, now here we're starting with the chapter, the sermon at Benares. And sermon is a talk with a message. Yeah, that is here we have, right, it is important, it's a lecture, but with a lecture you also contain an important message. You are teaching an important life lesson. Now here we're talking about, right, the sermon of Gautam Buddha. And at Benares, it was said that he delivered his first sermon entered some Ayush is in the class only. Ayush is in the class, he's there only. Yes. Right, so here sermon is a lecture, and as I said, Gautam Buddha, he delivered his first sermon along the banks of Benares, right? And what was that sermon? It was something so simple, so basic. It is something that people are all aware of. But when people, you know, with examples or with a story they teach us, we are able to understand them even better, right? This is a story about this lady who's lost her son, and how she goes, you know, asking everybody in the village to bring back her son to life, right? But it is in this story itself that we learn that death is inevitable. There is no house, there is no family in the world that has not been touched by death. So there are certain things in life that we cannot change, right? We need to accept them. It's very difficult to let go of our near and dear ones, but we have to accept the fact that can think about them, we can keep them alive in our memories, but we have to let go of them at some time or the other, right? So let's start with this chapter here, right? It is what? See, Gautam Buddha began life as a prince named Siddhartha Gautam. We know about the life of Gautam Buddha, right? How he was born a prince, but then he gave up all the worldly luxuries and gave up all the, you can say, material goods, and went on to seek the message about life and his journey for truth, right? In northern India, at 12, he was sent away for schooling in the Hindu sacred scriptures, and 4 years later, he returned home to marry a princess. They had a son and lived for 10 years as befitted royalty. At about the age of 25, the prince, heretofore shielded from the sufferings of the world, while out hunting, chanced upon a sick man, then an aged man, then a funeral procession, and finally a monk begging for alms. These sights so moved him that he at once went out into the world to seek enlightenment concerning the sorrows he had witnessed. So right, so he was living happy in his life, he went to the Gurukul, he got his education, married a princess, he enjoyed his life as a prince, as a rule, right? But then once at the age of 25, when he was outside, and you know how princes and how people there from the royalty, they're shielded from the rest of the world. They really don't know what is suffering. They don't realize what are the problems in the outside world. Do you remember the story, The Happy Prince, that you read in class 9, I think so? Do you remember the story? Yes? So the happy prince, that the statue of the prince is made, and how he is you know, like and yes. So when he is there as a statue, he is able to see all the problems and all the miseries of the world, and how he realizes his poverty, and he sees so many things happening, and how one by one he gives away all his jewels, right? There's a swallow, there's a bird who helps him, right? Remember that story? And how the prince there in his life, he did not see what was happening in the world. But when he was a statue, he saw so much pain and suffering in the world. Now here, Gautam Buddha, when he became the prince, one day when he was outside, he did not know that there was so much of pain. And he saw all this. He saw an old man, he saw a dead man, he saw a sick person, he saw a monk begging for alms, you know. And then he realized that there is so much of suffering. And yes, he went on. He left his worldly pleasures, he left his life in the palace and went out to seek the answers to these questions. Why do these things happen? Right? He wandered for 7 years and finally sat down under a peepal tree where he vowed to stay until enlightenment came. Right? Enlightened after 7 days, he renamed the tree the Bodhi tree. Tree of wisdom, and began to teach and to share his new understanding. So he searched for the truth, he searched for the meaning of life, and yes, so people, you come and join and leave the classroom again and again. So it does create a problem, you know, entering you again and again. So please try to join the class on time, okay? Right, all of you. Yes, please be regular and join the class on time. Yes, so enlightened after 7 days, he renamed the tree the Bodhi tree, the tree of wisdom, and began to teach and to share his new understandings, right? And he wanted the world to know, and that is where we talk about, you know, the beginning of Buddhism. We talk about the way of life that he learned. At that point, he became known as the Buddha. The awakened or the enlightened, the Buddha preached his first sermon at the city of Benares, most holy of the dipping places on the river Ganges. That sermon has been preserved and is given. It reflects the Buddha's wisdom about one inscrutable kind of suffering. So Buddha taught a very important lesson about So what is his story? What was the first sermon that Gautam Buddha gave at the banks of Banaras, right? In Banaras, sorry, along the banks of the Ganges. And Banaras, as we know, it is said to be one of the holiest cities, isn't it? Right? So here, this is where he gave his first sermon. Kissa Gautami had an only son and he died. In her grief, she carried the dead child to all her neighbors, asking them for medicine. And the people said, she has lost her senses. The boy is. At length, Kissa Gautami met a man who replied to her request. I cannot give thee medicine for thy child, but I know a physician who can. So the lady was very shocked at the death of her young child. And she was carrying the child to her neighbors and asking that if anybody could give medicine and bring the child back to life. And the people, they thought that she's gone crazy. The boy is dead. He cannot come back to life. Then one of the neighbors, what did he say? One of the persons said that I know a physician who can give you a medicine. Please go to that person. And the girl said, pray tell me, sir, who is it? And the man replied, go to Sakyamuni, the Buddha. Right? And yes, so he told him that you can go to him. Kissa Gautami repaired to the Buddha and cried, Lord and Master, give me the medicine that will cure my boy. So she has a lot of hope. She wants a child to come back to life and asking him that please give me the medicine. Right? So she goes over there. The Buddha answered, I want a handful of mustard seed. And when the girl in her joy promised to procure it, the Buddha added, the mustard seed must be taken from a house where no one has lost a child, husband, parent, or friend. Says, I have the medicine for you. Bring mustard seeds for me, but bring the mustard seed from a house where there has been no death, where no loss has happened, right? No one has lost a child, a husband, a parent, or a friend. So please go over there. Poor Kissa Gautami now went from house to house, and the people pitied her and said, here is mustard seed, take it. But when she asked, did a son or daughter, father, mother die in your family? They answered, alas, the living are few, but the dead are many. Do not remind us of our deepest grief. And there was no house, but some beloved one had died in it. Okay, right. I have Alexa waiting outside to join the meeting. Right, very creative. Some person is there. And yes, so Kissa Gautami went and she would take the mustard seed, would happily give her the mustard seed. But yes, they said, you know, there is no house in this world. In fact, the living are less than the people who have died, you know, and that's very, very true. She said there is no house where no near and dear one has Kissa Gautami became weary and hopeless and sat down at the wayside watching the lights of the city as they flickered up and were extinguished again. At last, the darkness of the night reigned everywhere, and she considered the fate of men that the lights flicker up and are extinguished again. And she thought to herself, you know, sometimes we are there so absorbed in our life, we are so absorbed in our near and dear ones that it sometimes becomes very difficult for us to accept the reality. What had happened with Kissa Gautami, it is something that happens with everyone. Where there is life, there is bound to be death. This is the inevitable truth of life, and we need to accept it. Okay, right? So it was, she went from house to house asking for mustard seeds. She got the mustard seeds. But yes, the people, they say that it's not possible, you know, that yes, we've lost someone, right? So whether it was a daughter, a son, mother, father, they have lost, right? And
Then when she was sitting alone and she was so tired and she was hopeless, she sat down, you know, like what was happening around her. She saw the lights of the city. It was getting dark. Everywhere, in every home, there was a light. And after some time, the lights, they went out. And again, they were lit up. At last, the darkness of the night reigned everywhere. Then it became completely dark. So what is the comparison? What is this symbolism that she has made? She considered the fate of men. We all have a light in us, isn't it? Right? And the light keeps us alive. And once again, you know, it is extinguished. That light in us, that flame in us, it gets extinguished. And then our life is over. This is the reality of life, bitter reality of life. And she thought to herself, how selfish I am in my grief. Death is common to all. Yet in this valley of desolation, there is a path that leads into immortality who has surrendered all selfishness. So when we start, you know, once again, quality of being selfish, right? Remember in the poem also we had discussed that humans are there, so selfish. But once we give up that quality of selfishness, one means we start, stop thinking about ourselves only and wonder why this happened to me. And then we realize that it happens with everybody. Only then we will understand the truth of life, okay? Right? So that death is common to all. It happens with everybody. And there is a path that leads into immortality who has surrendered all selfishness. When we surrender our selfishness, yes, we might immortal, not in our physical form. We can't be, because man is mortal. Man is destined to come to an end. But our thoughts, our thinking, our behavior, that is what makes us immortal. We live on even after we have left. The Buddha said, the life of mortals in this world is troubled and brief and combined with pain. As long as we are alive, we have our worries. We have our problems, right? We are there considering this and that. Right now, we are also there going through, you can say that phase of a life we are worried about. What is going to happen? For there is not any means by which those that have been born can avoid dying. So yeah, when you're born, you're bound to die. This is the truth of life. We are mortal. And yes, one day this light, this flame within us, it will get extinguished. When and how, we don't know. After reaching old age, there is death. Of such a nature are living beings. So right after, when we are, you know, like, yes, this phase of life, it happens, your infant, your childhood, your youth, your adulthood, your old age, and then of course life gets over. But nowadays life is so uncertain that anything can happen at any age, you know, so it's not a very hard and fast rule. So as ripe fruits are early in danger of falling, so mortals when born are always in danger of death. But if we keep on living in the fear of death, oh, I'm going to die, then we will not be able to live this life. So we have to face the problems in life. There are so many realities of life that we have to accept. So mortals when born are always in the danger of death, as all earthen vessels made by the potter end in being broken, so is the life of mortals. They say pot, you know, like earthen pot, it breaks. Similarly, like this, a life also gets over. We end our life, we leave this world. How we leave it? Let's leave it in a way that people remember us, they talk about us. Okay, right. Fine. And both young and adult, both those who are fools and those who are wise, all fall into the power of death, all are subject to death. Yes. So this is a very important life lesson here that we learn from this chapter, isn't it?